Well, good morning, and can I welcome everybody to this, the second meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2023. The first item on our agenda is for members of the committee to consider taking agenda items 3 and 4 in private. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
We are agreed. Thank you very much. And the principal item that we have on our agenda this morning is consideration of the 2021 to 2022 audit of the Scottish Government's consolidated accounts. And I'm pleased to welcome our witnesses this morning, the Auditor General for Scotland, Stephen Boyle, who's joined by Michael Oliphant, who's an audit director, and by Helen Russell, who's a senior audit manager at Audit Scotland. We've got quite an extensive range of questions to put this morning, but before we get to that, Auditor General, can I ask you to make a short opening statement? Thank you.
Many thanks, Convener. Good morning, Committee. I'm presenting this report on the 2021-22 audit of the Scottish Government under Section 22 of the Public Finance and Accountability Scotland Act 2000. The Scottish Government's annual consolidated accounts are a critical component of its accountability to Parliament and the public. The consolidated accounts cover over 90% of the budget that was approved by the Parliament for that year. The accounts show what the Government spent against each main budget heading and the reasons for any significant differences or variances. They also show the assets, liabilities and other financial commitments that is carrying forward to future years. My independent opinion on the consolidated accounts is unqualified. That means that I'm confident that they provide a true and fair view of the Government's finances and that they meet legal and accounting requirements. Convener, there are three areas from my report I would like to highlight. The first is on budget performance. Net spending for the year was £49.2 billion, £2 billion less than budget, an underspend of just about 4%. Spending levels remained significantly higher than pre-pandemic financial years, with around £5.8 billion of the 21-22 expenditure relating to the COVID-19 response. The second area is on financial sustainability. The Scottish Government is facing intense challenges in managing its finances as tougher economic conditions, such as higher inflation, increased interest rates emerge. Public sector pay issues remain unresolved in several key sectors. The demand for health and social care services remains unsustainable, and the number of people accessing social security benefits is significant. These highlight just some of the areas that will add further financial pressures both in the current year and beyond. I welcome the Government's increased focus on financial sustainability and the longer-term focus on managing its finances. It will be important for the Government to ensure its policy choices, therefore, and spending commitments are fully costed in forthcoming budgets, and to ensure its approach to using reserves is more transparent, particularly where there are funding implications for the wider public sector. The third area is on financial reporting. Last year, the Scottish Government committed to a revised timetable for the development of a devolved public sector account on a two-stage basis. However, progress in finalising the Stage 1 draft account remains slow. The need for a comprehensive assessment of the state of Scotland's public finances has never been greater, and I'm therefore asking the Scottish Government to move more swiftly to fulfilling their commitments in delivering this important account. Convener, as ever, my colleagues and I will do our best to answer the committee's questions this morning. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. And I'm going to turn straight away to Craig Hoy, who's got questions around financial management issues. Craig.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Mr. Boyle. Obviously, your report identifies a £2 billion underspend across both the capital and resource budgets. So I'm just wondering whether or not you consider that level of underspend to be reasonable, and is it reasonable to reflect and expect that the reason for a significant portion of that underspend relates to the COVID pandemic and the expenditure of those funds, especially given that effectively we're in year 2-3 of COVID, so we should have more predictability in the way in which those funds are dispersed.
Yeah, I'll bring Michael in a moment, Mr. Hoy, just to kind of set out some of the COVID dynamic of the underspend. In our paper today, our report, Exhibit 1, we look to set out really the range of underspends across different departmental headings that contribute primarily to a resource underspend. So a resource underspend of just under £2 billion. There are two main department lines that contribute to that most significantly: finance and economy, education and skills, actually, and a third, net zero and transport and energy. What is true is that the underspend today is larger than we've seen in previous years. And we do make the connection in our report that COVID and some of the unpredictability, I think we've been speaking to the committee over the past year, 18 months or so, about how monies would be spent for COVID and then when they were actually delivered. So as at the year end, and this is something of a snapshot, so this relates to the end of March 2022, monies that hadn't been spent would be reflected in that underspend. We go on to the report, Michael might want to say a bit more about this. Actually, what that then means is that as the public health crisis has ebbed, that monies that had been intended for a COVID response might not necessarily now need to be used in that way and will be available for other purposes. Before passing to Michael, last point I would make is that there's a transparency component to that as well. There's a visibility of what the money was intended for and what it will now be used in future. So we're again making the point in the government to improve the transparency of how it spends money relative to what was originally intended. I'll pause, Mr. Hoare. I think Michael might want to say a bit more about the COVID dynamic.
In relation to the overall underspend, so it's not, although it is higher than it has been in recent years, it's still low in percentage terms. I think by comparison, previous years underspends have been, you know, just over 1%. The underspend we've seen in the last year is 3.7%. The government can't overspend its budget, so it has quite a challenging job to get the underspend as low as possible. Looking at the underspend, it's important to be aware that only a proportion of that is money that can be, that's effectively cash, and that's transferred through the Scotland Reserve into subsequent financial years, which the Scottish Government has budgeted for. The vast majority of it, including £674 million in relation to student loans, these are technical accounting adjustments. They don't represent cash. Okay. So, for example, there was £300 million in relation to capital borrowing that wasn't used. That decision was made after the last opportunity to amend the budget. So your underspend ends up being higher than you perhaps would otherwise have wished, because the spring budget revision represents the last opportunity to amend the budget for the year.
Fine. And just looking at the COVID-related funds, it appears that business support and energy programmes are the two areas where there was perhaps a significant underspend. Does the scale of the underspend in those areas reflect any kind of structural issues in the way those funds were built, or any weaknesses in the approaches to the programme planning? I'm just thinking, for example, in relation to some funds that constituents contacted me about, the window of opportunity to apply for them was very short, and therefore there was underspend in relation to those programmes initiatives because they were undersubscribed. So is there an issue perhaps in the way that those funds were constructed?
Not that we're aware of, or not that we found during the course of the audit. I think given the nature and the dynamic of the COVID pandemic as it emerged, for example, the Omicron variant that emerged towards the end of last year, the government has to move quickly to pull funds together to make available funding for these different streams. I think clearly they've spent less than what they thought they would, but that money is not lost. It's then can be rerouted to other parts of the public sector. So it's, you know, for example, the £184 million underspend in business support schemes and also the self-isolation support grants. They've got to be led by applications, you know, so the demand has to be there in order for the amounts to be issued.
Yeah, and obviously there are rules governing how much can be carried over from one year to the next into the reserves. Is there a risk that any money was actually lost during that process, or can it all be redeployed into other areas?
The final amount is yet to be confirmed, but it's within the levels of they can put into the Scotland Reserve and draw down, and it's in line with what the government had announced at the provisional outturn statement back in June, around £650 million to transfer into the following years. So it's within the tolerance levels of the Scotland Reserve.
OK, just in relation to the capital expenditure, obviously there was a higher percentage underspent, I think it was 7.5%. That, I think, focused on energy and housing capital programmes. Is that underspend in any way going to jeopardise put in any risk in relation to meeting targets and outcomes in two quite important areas of the public policy landscape?
I think I'll maybe start on that point. I think it's hard to give you that definitive assurance one way or the other. I think we've, across capital programmes, one of the things that, you know, for businesses, public sector and private individuals have seen is that the cost of capital programmes is increasing. You know, there is a building inflation component that is making these projects more expensive. So it's not to say that the cost will be fixed or stable. I think we can safely say that the cost will be increasing. That there's an underspend, probably reflecting elements of the progress towards the delivery of the programmes. The money's not lost, it will be there, but it probably there is a need really for public bodies to make that assessment regularly about the future cost to deliver their capital ambitions.
Fine. And just going back to COVID and the issue of transparency, obviously there was a huge amount of money came forward to support public services and the public through the pandemic, I think £5.8 billion during the 2021-22 period. Do you consider it the Scottish Government has done enough to respond to concerns around transparency and the reporting of COVID-19 spend? And is there any sort of legitimacy in fears that money was being squirrelled away that was destined, or should have been destined for COVID projects for other areas of government expenditure?
I think we've been pretty consistent on this, actually, and a recognition that the systems of budgeting, budget amendments and then subsequent financial reporting weren't designed to cope with the volume of change that we've seen over the course of the pandemic. I've lost count, Mr. Hoy, but I remember previous discussions with the committee that there were many hundreds of separate funding announcements at the earlier stages of the pandemic. Our budget reporting system doesn't allow for that level of volatility. We've made the recommendation, and we repeat the general transparency point in today's report, actually, that the need to take stock of the experience of the pandemic, and is there enough transparency and visibility for Parliament and for decision makers in public bodies to support good, effective, high quality public spending. On the question as to whether or not the monies haven't been used, I think, as Michael said, that ultimately within the confines of the fiscal framework, underspends where they're not of a technical nature, as we refer to in student loans, will be made available in subsequent budget years through the Scotland Reserve provision. So we make one further final point, actually. I think it would be helpful for the more visibility around the Scotland Reserve that the numbers, and really I think the Scottish Government's consolidated accounts would be a useful place for which to set that out more clearly.
Yeah. And just looking at past expenditure, and obviously as we come through the recovery, what further action do you think it would be appropriate for the Scottish Government to take in order to address any remaining or ongoing concerns around the transparency of those COVID monies?
So we think it would be kind of helpful to set out as a piece the totality of the COVID-related spending, the subsequent budget announcements, and then ultimately what was achieved for in terms of outcomes for that spending. How the government chooses to do that, I think it will be a matter for them to set that out. It probably speaks to the point that I think we've made in our more recent reports, actually, that it's becoming harder to track COVID-related activity in terms of public spending. You'll know, Mr. Hoy, in the committee will be familiar that there is no separate COVID-related budget as there were in previous iterations. But there is still COVID-related activity. You know, I think we're seeing some of the tail and its impact on public services. So I think rounding that off would be a helpful point to support Parliament's understanding and public scrutiny.
And from an audit perspective, obviously, do you plan any further work in relation to that, or will you wait to see where the government gets to and then just report through approaches such as this?
We're giving that some thought at the moment, as to how best to round off our specific COVID-related work. The last paper that we took to the committee recognised that there were still some unresolved public spending, so we want to just to fulfil our obligations in terms of COVID. So we hope to clarify our thinking that in the next few weeks, and we'll update the committee in due course.
Thank you very much.
Willie Coffey wanted to come in this area as well, so Willie.
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener. Auditor General, it's just on the education underspend that was discussed a moment ago. The, it represents almost a third of the entire underspend, but as it turns out, it's not actually real money. It's a technical adjustment. I think, Mr. Oliphant, you gave a figure of £674 million. Why is that so high? That's a huge technical adjustment, isn't it?
It is, actually, and Michael is well placed to kind of talk the committee through that. In general terms, it relates to the scale of student loans that's reflected in the Scottish Government's accounts is a significant number. So any marginal changes in interest rates that apply to that in themselves reflect a significant adjustment. That's in broad terms. Michael's better placed to give a more detailed answer.
Yeah, So the student loans model is a very complex model. It relies on a number of external factors, a lot of economic variables. Every year there's a charge to the model that represents the cost to the Scottish Government of issuing loans. And that is based on the likelihood that loans will be repaid. So it's linked to future, likely future earnings and so on. What we've seen in this year that's been sort of quite unusual compared to previous years is a big movement in interest rates. So at the start of the year, the RPI was 1.5%. It moved to 9% during the year. So that really impacts the calculation when you're discounting the values back to the present day to derive a charge. So that's where you get a very significant adjustment, but it's not cash, it's a technical adjustment that's required in the accounts to represent the cost of the Scottish Government issuing loans.
Okay, thanks for that. And the difference between those two figures then, the £806 million reported in the report and your figure of £674, Michael, is the difference, the £132 million difference, is that deployable elsewhere and can that be carried forward to other expenditure elsewhere topics or items, or has it got to be for student loans?
So it will be other parts of the education budget.
Okay, yeah. Okay. Thanks for that, Convener.
Thank you. Colin Beattie's got some questions, but I know Colin has also got to go and give a presentation to another committee. So do you want to take your questions now or do you want to leave it?
I think there's not time at the moment.
That's fine.
If you're okay.
Yeah, that's absolutely fine. That's absolutely fine. Well, Auditor General, can I turn to a section of the report which seems to be a recurring section of the report, and that is the financial position of the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. People will have no doubt been aware of outstanding cases against the Lord Advocate in connection with the acquisition of Rangers Football Club. And the report sets out it says that the cases that have been resolved total £36.5 million in costs up to March 2022, and a further £24.5 million are provided in respect of cases still to be finalised. So the question is, one, what do you think that means for the overall financial position of that office? And secondly, could you maybe update us on where those outstanding cases are, and are there still further cases yet to be settled?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I'll say, I think, as much as we're able to, and I think the position that we set out in the report is consistent with our understanding and my colleagues' engagement with the auditors of the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal. Helen might want to come in a moment and say a bit more about the detail of that. What we set out in the report and the figures that you quote are the two components. One is the settlement arrangements that have already been entered into of £35.5 million. And then an assessment that's been made of the likely additional costs, the amounts that have been provided, that bring us to a collective figure of around £60 million of public expenditure that has been paid as a result of the arrests and prosecutions of those connected with the acquisition of Rangers Football Club. You'll know, Convener, that the government has committed to holding a judge-led inquiry into the circumstances, and that's why we have chose to report the public expenditure related to that through the Scottish Government Section 22. We haven't taken any view whether there'll be any further audit-related reporting in respect of the matter until we see the conclusion of any judge review of the circumstances. I'll pause. I think Helen might want to add a little bit about the other discussions we've had with the auditors, if she wishes.
Thank you. So, as at the 31st of March 2022, £11 million was paid during that particular year. £24 million had been spent in the previous financial year, which totals a £35 million you just heard about. The provision of £24.5 million refers to a few more cases that are still outstanding, of which you'll probably be aware that a payment of around about £15 million was made in October of 2022. So that reduces the provision somewhat down to about £9 million at this point. That's probably all I would want to add just now. I'm happy to take any other questions.
OK, but, and you describe in the report the £60 million additional payout from the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service as unplanned costs. Could you give us an idea of how much £60 million compares to the annual budget of that public service?
Yeah, Convener, I'll just draw the committee's attention to Exhibit 1. The last line but one in the table sets out the budget of £180 million for the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service relative to expenditure of £185 million, so an overspend within that budget line of £5 million. The government, together with the Crown Office, clearly have an obligation as they determine it. They have made payments out to those who have pursued in respect of the Rangers case. There have been subsequent budget adjustments during the year to allow for the additional liabilities related to it. So it's not insignificant, I think, to answer, you know, as it relates to the overall running of the Crown Office. And as Helen mentions, that those additional payments being made in October in this of 22 in this new financial year, that will also need to be reflected in the budget and the calculations for the 22-23 year.
OK, thank you. I'm going to move on now and invite Sharon Dowie to ask some questions. Sharon.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I'm going to ask some questions in borrowing. So the report notes that the Scottish Government can borrow £450 million per year up to a cumulative total of £3 billion for capital spending. It then says that capital borrowing in 2021-22 was £150 million. And has been below the £450 million threshold in each of the last 4 years. Also says that there's limited information on how capital borrowing is being used. And goes on to say the Scottish Government can also borrow for resource spending up to a maximum of £300 million per year and up to a cumulative maximum of £1,750 million. So the question: is the Scottish Government sufficiently transparent about its decisions to undertake both capital and resource borrowing?
We think there's more the government can do in terms of setting out its capital resource borrowing and what it is using those borrowing amounts to deliver outcomes as part of its programme of work. The parameters for borrowing are set within the fiscal framework between the Scottish Government and the UK Government, both in terms of resource and capital borrowing. But there is insufficient detail within the consolidated accounts. There are some disclosures, I should say, within the Scottish Consolidated Fund accounts, which set out and repeat and we've used the numbers within the Section 22 report to reflect that. But in the use of a single document of the consolidated accounts, we don't think there's enough detail. And the predecessor committee, the Public Audit and Post-Legislative Scrutiny Committee, took evidence from government officials, I think back in 2018-19, where you explored this point about the relationship between capital borrowing and then what it was being used for. Our position remains the same, Deputy Convener, that there needs to be clear transparency and a clearer link between what capital borrowing is being used and which projects it is being used to support. Our expectation is that that information is available, that ultimately to secure the borrowing from the National Loans Fund and the relationship with HM Treasury is that government in Scotland would be placed to set that out for what it intends to use it. So we think that could be better set out more transparently than it is currently being done. So
thank you for that. So what better information could be provided then to support effective scrutiny in respect of the use of capital borrowing powers and specific projects that it's supporting?
Well, exactly that. So there isn't a clear enough description of which projects the capital borrowing is being used for. Instead, it's in totality of overall borrowing arrangements. And given that there are specific requirements, there are thresholds, there are caps on capital borrowing, we think it would be a stronger financial management description, more transparent, if that was included within the consolidated accounts for government that sets out what's been borrowed and then how that money is being used. So that remains our position, that there is more transparency that could be achieved.
Right, thank you. Do you have any concerns in relation to the increasing level of repayment charges in relation to the borrowing, and does the Scottish Government take any view on what it is considering reasonable?
I'll turn to Michael in a moment, if there's anything he wishes to add on this point. What is clear is that the government is borrowing more, as it's as we're now a number of years into this fiscal framework. I appreciate there are discussions ongoing between the Scottish Government and the UK Government about any modifications to the fiscal framework. But as borrowing levels are increasing, that comes with further repayment requirements. We've seen the volatility in interest rates and inflation rates. So what it all speaks to is a more complex picture that requires careful management. So we know that the government is within the confines of the fiscal framework limits, but it requires careful management as the number of projects and borrowing increases. And that, not just for government's benefit, but really for Parliament and for the public, that's more clearly set out. Michael is closer to some of the detail of how this works, and he may wish to say a bit more.
I think at this stage, our concern, if I can phrase it like that would be that they're just aware of the repayment charges that go with that. So repaying the capital as well as the interest rates. We've noted that it's £95 million in the last financial year. So the more they borrow, the more the repayments will increase, and so on. And that takes up a bigger proportion of your available money in each year. Mm-hmm. There's a balance to be struck in the government in determining how much that they will borrow in each year. They need to look at the levels of repayments over a number of years, the sources of borrowing, as well as, for example, when we talked about capital, the default position is that you would borrow capital over 10 years. In line with the fiscal framework, but the fiscal framework allows you, the Scottish Government, to agree with the UK Government either a smaller time or a longer time frame. So these all need to be factored in to the overall model and the repayments that would come with that. And it's something the government need to consider on an annual basis in terms of new borrowing, but also the level of repayments they have to make as part of that year's budget.
Okay, thank you. Moving on now to investment in private companies. So specifically, it's mentioned Prestwick Airport, Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow Holdings Limited, Brompton Slim Fabrications Limited, or Bifab, and Lochaber Aluminium Smelter. So, starting with Prestwick Airport, what are the financial implications for the Scottish Government of continued failure to find a buyer for the airport?
We set out at paragraph 32 just with some of the history and the totality of government support since the airport was purchased by the Scottish Government in November 2013. Up to the end of March 2022, it provided loan support of £43.4 million. And as any loans that a lender makes. They have to assess the recoverability, the value of that loan, and government's assessment is that that's now valued at £11.6 million. So, and on paper, I think it's an important point to stress, and on paper, loss of £31.8 million. Interest in that is had been accrued at £7.4 million, and that's currently valued at nil as well. So going back nearly 10 years, the valuation reflects a loss of over £31 million. What we don't have detailed insight, Deputy Convener, as to what comes next. We know that there had been discussions to find a buyer, but that's not yet come to fruition. So I don't have an annualised figure in my mind to see what the government's support will mean for Prestwick Airport, but you can see on an annual basis many millions of pounds of public expenditure are being used to support the airport, to sustain jobs, the services within the airport, and that will remain the case for as long as it remains in public sector hands.
Okay, thank you. Moving on to the smelter. Paragraph 32 notes the Scottish Government issued a 25-year financial guarantee contract to CIMIC Lochaber Hydropower Limited in 2016. It also mentions the complexity of the financial arrangements. So what are the implications of the continued high level of provision in relation to the Scottish Government's financial guarantees to the smelter?
I'll bring Michael in, actually, on this. I think it's probably worth to set out in a bit of detail in addition to what we have in the paper. Really, the complexity that you refer to of this arrangement, government's support for the arrangement, and also the financial consequences of it. There's both annualised implications and also longer term. What we've seen and what we've, through our audit work, is we're satisfied with the disclosures that the government has made in the accounts, both in terms of the asset for the fee for the guarantee, but also its longer term potential liability. All of this is complicated, of course, by some of the external factors relating to the variety of companies and their funding arrangements associated with the smelter. Before passing to Michael, Deputy Convener, I reiterate my commitment and long-standing interest in this, and we're continuing to monitor the progress with the investment and the viability of the smelter through our audit work, and we'll report further as necessary. I'll stop. I think Michael might want to come in on some of the detail.
So the financial guarantee contract is still in place. The 25 years will continue unless something happens. That's where the uncertainty is, and it really relates to the financial standing of parent companies, so GFG Alliance, but also the Lochaber Hydro and the smelter itself. At the moment, you know, all payments are up to date as far as our, you know, audit work has looked at. Where the is an insolvency event or something that would trigger a call on the guarantee, that's where a series of events would kick in. For example, if there was a call in the guarantee, then the Scottish Government would have to pay Greenshill, who a special purpose vehicle, who purchased all future payments to the Hydro Co from the smelter. Sorry, and these were bonds that were placed with investors. The Scottish Government would then claim that back from GFG Alliance, but depending on the financial position there, that would probably be unlikely. So the Scottish Government would call on the security package they've got, which involves the land, the smelter, the assets itself. So their full exposure is reduced by the value that they would get from the potential sale. And then that arrives at the provision that's within the accounts. At the moment, you know, nothing has happened to trigger such an event, but it's still quite risky because, as we know, GFG Alliance are going through a sort of global refinancing, mm-hmm. and so on. They're under investigation by the Serious Fraud Office. So there's still that risk there, and that's why it has to be accounted for appropriately.
Okay, Okay, thank you. And moving on again, in March 2022, the Scottish Government published its business investment framework to outline its principles and approach for decisions about future investment in private companies. Does it provide a sufficiently robust framework in relation to informing decision-making in this area?
I think the first thing we say, and Michael may want to come in because he's had much involvement in this, is that we welcome the progress. Actually, that we now have, or the government now has a business investment framework to support any investments that it or its public bodies will be making in private companies. And I think it's the reasons why this was important, why both myself and my predecessor were commenting that this felt like a real gap in terms of government's investment architecture, probably borne out by some of the investments that we refer to in the paper that haven't been successful and are unlikely to deliver value for money. Having said that, Deputy Convener, we go on to say in the paper that we think there's scope for further development of it in terms of financial controls over interventions, a rounded assessment of how the investment will support public jobs and growth opportunities, and then the overall balance and component of risk appetite. So a qualified welcome, I think we can define it as, it's important that it's now in place, but we think there's opportunity for government to do more to satisfy itself that this provides it with the framework that its investments. And bear in mind that the investments that the government itself are likely to make will be those that are higher risk. So they're likely to be opportunities that have come their way when companies have exhausted other opportunities, mm-hmm. whether it's private finance, other public sector support through enterprise companies, and therefore it matters that this is tight and all of the risks and opportunities are properly weighed up. So we think there is a couple of final steps that government can do just to make sure that that's rounded off in respect of its management of risk.
Thank you, and that brings me on to my last question. Is there sufficient transparency in relation to the Scottish Government's investment in private companies, including the rationale for investment and the reasons behind failed or rejected bids for subsequent sale of investments, and how could transparency in this area be improved?
I think trying to be slightly pragmatic about this, because we recognise that these are commercial transactions and there's an inevitability that many of those conversations need to take place behind closed doors so that it respects the commercial confidentiality of it. Balanced against that, it is public money. These are public investments. Public Parliament will want to be satisfied that government is getting best value for its investment. Transparency has to happen, but also has to happen at the right time. So it's a long-standing point that I've made, and Audit Scotland has made, actually there needs to be improved transparency around investments and outcome and exit arrangements for investment in private companies.
Thank you.
I'm going to bring Willie Coffey in, but before I do, could I just go back to what you said about the business investment framework? I think you said it was almost there, but I mean, if I look at the summary document, it says that this guidance is not exhausted because each investment decision is different and will have its own unique characteristics. I mean, that sounds like a continuation of the approach which has been the one followed hitherto, which is it's all case by case. I mean, does that sound different to that to you?
I think it probably speaks to the point that we referred to in the paper, Convener, that there's an implication of flexibility therein, and perhaps too much flexibility to support a consistent review and assessment of what government's intended outcomes are for their investment, that there's clarity on public spending, that the totality of what will be achieved, whether it's growth, job opportunities and management of risk. So I think we wouldn't want to say that there hasn't been progress. I think our assessment is that government and its officials are in a better place to make effective investment, but we do think there are a number of steps missing, and one of those includes the extended flexibility on offer.
Okay. I mean, further into the document, it talks about the comprehensive business case which needs to be made in order to give the green light to a government intervention in a commercial business. And it talks about the strategic case, the economic case, the commercial case, the financial case, the management case. Do you think any of those cases were met, were the subject of proper scrutiny in those investments which are listed in your report?
I think that's relatively straightforward to say that the investments listed weren't subject to the rigour that the government is now trying to bring in through this enhanced in business investment framework. It probably speaks to our view that progress has been made. It's all well and good having it down on paper. I think the test will be that when future opportunities are applied against the new investment framework, and where appropriate, and I think this is the harder point, actually, that maybe the Deputy Convener's question about transparency, actually, is that where the investment's been made, government will want to satisfy and report that it's applied all of these tests, but it would be equally valuable where they haven't chosen to invest, that there's evidence that actually the framework was robust and led it to a point that investment wasn't deemed appropriate because of the extent of risk. I appreciate that it's harder, but it's something that we would encourage government to think about how it could best illustrate both where they've chosen to and not to make those investments.
Yeah, I mean, are you aware of any instances where the government has decided against making an investment according to those criteria since that was published in March?
I'll bring colleagues in if we have any examples to mind. We know generally that perhaps before the framework that they had decided not to make some investments. So government receives requests repeatedly from businesses where they enter into financial distress. There's been some high-profile examples of where that's not the case. But in terms of more recent, since the framework's come into fruition, I'll check. If not, we can check our records and come back to the committee in writing, convener.
So, not that we're aware of specific cases. Part of that is the development of the strategic commercial assets division has been created to effectively carry out the work that's behind the framework. They were due to really get up and running in December there. So we would expect that to be a key part of the work of that division. And it's something that we'll be looking at as part of our ongoing audit work to see both the investments that they're considering, albeit with that element of commercial confidentiality, but particularly the cases where they're committing public funds, but just an indication of where they're deciding not to invest and the reasons for that. And some of the reasons may well be they can use enterprise agencies. They might get access to funding from banks and so on. So the support is not always of a financial nature, but that will really bring to fruition how successful the framework has been. But as the Auditor General says, we feel as if there's steps that they could do to strengthen the framework beyond its current status.
Okay. I just want to touch finally on the situation with the GFG Alliance, and I welcome your commitment this morning, Auditor General, that this is an area of continuing interest to you. So we've seen it, I think, in the financial year covered by this report, the supply chain banker Greensill Capital, the supply chain banker to GFG Alliance, went into administration. As Michael Oliphant mentioned, the Serious Fraud Office are looking at the GFG Alliance around concerns over fraud and money laundering. GFG's own auditors quite unusually resigned. I think the finance director left. They've been described by another parliamentary committee as being opaque in their corporate structure. I understand that the most recent accounts for the Lochaber smelter are not going to be audited. I mean, do you have a view about the overall risk that we now seem to be facing here?
All of these are concerning factors, convener, actually, about the transparency the complexity of this arrangement. Stepping back to the point really Michael describes, that there is both exposure to the Scottish Government in annual terms and totality that are set out in the accounts. At the initial point of the deal, they took steps to safeguard their risk. So there are guarantees and there are security in place. However, it's unclear yet what all of these factors will mean about ultimately whether that complexity of transaction will have to be unravelled. You know, and ultimately, it's something we're keeping a close eye on, but you can see from the kind of detail that's set out in the report and also that you describe, it's a really volatile set of circumstances. And as we have seen in other fast-moving cases, that this can all unravel potentially quite quickly. And we know that government is watching carefully and what it means. We make reference in our report the role of Highland Council, similarly to secure the provision, the continued operation of the plant. Beyond just our ongoing commitment, convener, we're keeping a close eye on this, and as necessary, we'll be undertaking further audit work.
But as the Auditor General, do you have a view about reports that the most recent accounts of the Lough Arbour smelter are not going to be audited?
So I think that is concerning, actually, and we would agree that there are, for all investments that public bodies make, we would want to see that level of transparency. So not having a set of accounts audited is a concern. It matters, therefore, that government, as one of the investment partners, satisfies itself about the integrity of its investment. Really, that's my overall point, is we continue to engage with government so that it can satisfy itself about the integrity of its investment and its associated liability. It's very much part of our work during the 22-23 audit.
Thank you. That message is received loud and clear. Willie Coffey, you wanted to come in.
Yeah, thanks again, Convener, Auditor General. Can I take you back to Prestwick Airport briefly and some of the comments that you've made in relation to the airport? And you've said a couple of times in response to questions that this investment and maybe one or two of the others that have been discussed are unlikely to achieve value for money. I'm interested in how Audit Scotland defines value for money, because when you look at the wider circumstances at somewhere like Prestwick, you can see that the investment with the government saved the airport, saved the jobs. Mm-hmm. That also happened at Ferguson's, where the workers agreed with that. The investment saved the yard, saved the jobs. The Ayrshire growth deal depends greatly on the existence of the airport to support the wider economy and the aerospace industry there. The Mangata investment's coming, bringing 575 jobs, which probably wouldn't come if the airport wasn't there. So given those kind of wider circumstances and all those impacts in the economy of Ayrshire, how is it possible that you can say that it's unlikely to deliver value for money?
I think we haven't formed an overall value for money judgment, I should say, Mr. Coffey, on the investment in Prestwick Airport specifically. We have come closer to being definitive, if we use those terms, about some of the other investments, but we have qualified our assessment on it, because what we haven't done is made a detailed review of some of these investments in the way that we've had a more focused interest on in other areas, such as our report on the Clyde and Hebridean ferries, that where we've said once to that effect unlikely to deliver value for money back in our report in February. In terms of the original investment, we've discussed some of the figures in Prestwick already. When the investment was made, we were clear that government hadn't formed a totality of its understanding of what the overall investment would be, what the intended outcomes for that investment would achieve. Typically, I think we've seen from the new business investment framework, all of those components need to be factored in at an early stage. So we're not challenging the value that has come from the new jobs that you referred to the airport, but these weren't part of the assessment at the time that the original intervention was made. And that's why we're welcoming a stronger framework to make assessments on what the intended outcomes most crucially would be, and part of that is value for money. So it's a qualified position from us absolutely at this stage, and we'll, and in the event of undertaking any further work in terms of performance audit and value for money, that would be part of our thinking.
Thank you for that. Is it a matter of getting the money back that you invested? Is that the principal concern for years on at Scotland sees it, is it about getting the money back? When you look on balance at that investment and the other investments and benefits that I've described there, for you, is it principally about financial transaction and getting that cash back at some point?
No, it isn't. No, it's not. Right. It's not about getting the money back. It's about actually when public money has been invested, that the intended outcomes are clear as to what's going to be achieved from that. These are clearly long-term commitments. They're taking many millions of pounds of public expenditure. And really for any investment, whether it's public sector or private sector, where you're investing for that amount, it really goes back to business case. What do you intend to achieve from that? And I think for many of the investments that we set out in private companies, the intended outcomes were less clear right at the start. So the financial value is one part of it, but much more significantly for all public investment, what was actually achieved, what was hoped to achieve, and that's the measure that all of our audit work is based upon, where the policy objectives delivered and did they ultimately produce value for money.
Thanks for that.
Thanks very much, Willie. I think we're going to turn now to you again, because I know that you've got questions around the replacement for European Union structural funds and how they are going to be audited and overseen. So, Willie, back to you.
Yeah, thanks again, Convener. Yes, Auditor General, it's really about the section in the report about European structural funds and their replacement. We had some wonderful news last night announced on the media that some of the initial projects in the Levelling Up Fund, totalling £177 million, I think, very welcome as it is. You know, I know, members know that we pride ourselves in this Parliament, in this committee, of the scrutiny, governance and accountability processes that apply and the rigour that applies to these processes. So where do you see these functions actually in that process of replacing the European structural funds with the levelling up funds? Where is that rigour, scrutiny and accountability taking place?
We are as enthusiastic as the committee is, Mr. Coffey, that there is rigour, transparency of public expenditure where it is being applied in Scotland. The levelling up funds, the successor arrangements and the shared prosperity fund, there is no statutory role for Audit Scotland or the Auditor General in respect of the successor arrangements. Previously, we have provided the Public Audit Committee with information around structural funds. We look to do so today as it relates to the flow of funds through the Scottish Government consolidated accounts. Both myself, the Accounts Commission for Scotland, which audits local government in Scotland, and Audit Scotland, are keen to maintain a level of transparency to support the committee's interest in how these funds are being spent. But that would be to support your information rather than providing you an audit opinion on how the funds have been spent. Ultimately, the flow of funds is now from the UK government to individual bodies, public sector or third sector in Scotland. So there'll be a variety of arrangements. So myself and the Accounts Commission Audit Scotland are working together really to support the committee's interest and look forward to continuing to engage with you. But it will be a different set of arrangements than we've known previously. But nonetheless, we're keen that that transparency of the totality of the money is clear. But as I say, Mr. Coffey, it won't be an audit of individual allocation of funds. That will be a matter for the UK government.
Thanks for that. I was speaking only last night to the leader of East Yorkshire Council, who himself is not aware of any scrutiny, governance or accountability arrangements being requested of the council by anyone in this issue. And it's been a recurring issue, as you know, Convener, at this committee for quite some time now, about where that scrutiny lies. Effectively, what we seem to be getting, Auditor General, is public investment announcements by press release. I mean, that could hardly pass as the kind of rigorous process that we pride ourselves in this Parliament, would you agree?
This is a matter for the Department for Levelling Up within the UK government as the funder for it to determine what audit and assurance arrangements it wishes for its public expenditure. A conversation that it, should it wish to have individual audits undertaken, that it would pursue with the UK National Audit Office. As ever, we look to support that. We look to support the Public Audit Committee and the Scottish Parliament's ongoing interest in it. So we, together with the Accounts Commission, whether in respect of local government funding, will look to provide information to the Public Audit Committee of the Scottish Parliament. But as I say, Mr Coffey, that will fall short of an audit, given that it's not part of our jurisdiction.
OK, we'll leave it at that. Thanks very much.
Thanks, Willie. Thank you. Can I turn now to another area of interest that the committee's got, which is highlighted in the report, and that's about the use of reserves. So you make the point in the report, again, the transparency issue. You say there is a need for greater transparency over the Scottish Government's policy and approach to using reserves to manage existing cost pressures, particularly where there are funding implications for the whole public sector. Could you elaborate a little bit on that and tell us what your concerns are?
Happy to do so, Convener. I'll bring Michael in as well to support my answer. I think perhaps to kind of turn to an example and really build on the question Mr Hoy asked us earlier this morning about the totality of the use of reserves. So how the Scotland Reserve operates is set out by the fiscal framework. There are reserves in other public bodies, principally local authorities in Scotland. And this year, the current financial year, there have been engagement between the Scottish Government and local authorities and integration joint boards about accessing some of the funding that had been intended for COVID to be used for other purposes, principally to support public sector pay arrangements. All of this has, perhaps by necessity, had to be quite flexible responding to events, but it doesn't really support transparency, parliamentary understanding, public understanding of what funding is sitting in reserve, how it's intended to be used, rather than it feeling quite flexible, reactive. So it brings us back to our overall point that there needs to be more transparency about how monies that are sitting in reserve, carried forward from one year to the next, will be used on a more medium-term and longer-term basis.
Okay. But, I mean, you do go even a bit further than that, don't you, when you say that the reserve balance is not disclosed within the Scottish Government's... So it's not just a matter of where it is and the transparency over the movement of it. You're saying it's not the figure itself is not even disclosed in the consolidated accounts.
Yeah, that's correct. Convener, Michael might want to explain why that is currently, but we're absolutely clear that there's a bit of a gap here. That given how important the Scotland Reserve is, its place within the fiscal framework arrangements of Scottish public finances, it would provide an overall picture of really what's available to the government to fulfil its ambitions where monies haven't been spent. And perhaps, given the scale of COVID investment there's been, the larger than typical underspend that exists this year, we think it would be more helpful to map that, to report that more clearly publicly. And the consolidated accounts feels like a very useful place with which to do that. Michael can say a bit more, Convener.
That's really the central point. We feel as if it's a missed opportunity not to have it within the consolidated accounts. The balances and the movements in and out, the Scotland Reserve, they're reported in other places, but that doesn't make it transparent. It has to be accessible to the user and so on, and clearly understood. I think I mentioned earlier in the session that the £650 million that we talked about that will be put forward into next year's budget, this year's budget, It was first kind of indicated back at the provision outturn statement to members of the Parliament back in June. But that's, you know, that's 6 months away from the conclusion of the accounts. So there's further sums that can go into the reserve balance, further drawdowns that can be made. It just feels as if there's, in the absence of any other account, it feels as if that would be the natural home for it. And it just provides that clarity of sight around the money that's been transferred from 1 year to the next.
Thanks. Which very much does lead me on to my next question, which is about where we are with the production of whole Scottish Government consolidated accounts, which I think rather diplomatically you said was being introduced at too slow a pace. I mean, could you tell us why there has been this lengthy delay and what justification has been presented for that delay?
I think that there's two or three factors that I would highlight, Convener. The first one, 7 years beyond the date that the government first committed to preparing a public consolidated account, there have been factors in the current year that have brought about slower progress. So the stage one account was provided to Audit Scotland for comment. We've done that over the course of the spring and the summer of this year. We haven't yet received it for audit. The second stage thereafter was to for government to bring in the wider parts of the public sector beyond the Scottish administration, which is the consolidated accounts and a few other bodies. That has been delayed because government in Scotland were planning to align the arrangements with the whole of government accounts. Whole of government accounts has suffered delays this year as a result of IT issues. So those are relevant factors in the current year. But as I say at the start, Convener, we're now 7 years into this, that there have been, and there will always be in-year challenges. There will be reprioritisation. But we've got a real gap that of, you know, a single picture of what Scotland owes, owns, what it spends and what its income is each year. We've touched a number of times this morning about transparency, which matters, but a single public sector account will help better decision making, you know, as for, and especially as we're moving into, and we are in, challenging financial times, prioritisation to support the government's plans around public sector reform, delivering its outcomes. In our view, a public sector account is an essential component of a rounded financial reporting, and we again repeat the call that for much quicker action to deliver it.
Okay, thank you. Well, we may well have the permanent secretary before us to give evidence in the ensuing weeks, so it may be something that we will raise with him. Colin Beattie has happily rejoined us, and Colin, I know you had questions on social security, which is again an important part of the report. So I'm going to invite you now to put those questions to the Auditor General.
Thank you, Mayor. Morning, Auditor General. I'm looking at an area that I've discussed before, which is about fraud, and specifically on the social security side. Now, the benefit expenditure administered by the Department of Works and Pensions, £3.3 billion. Now, according to this, you estimate that overpayments in Scotland could amount to £67.5 million. So there's two questions on that. How do you calculate that out of thin air? And secondly, is that a normal level? Is that what would be expected?
Yeah, good morning, Mr. Beattie. So there is a model and a rationale for the calculation of both benefits, which are subject to audit through the Audit of Social Security Scotland, and then really with any particularly a benefits system, there is an inherent understanding that some payments will be made in error, whether as a result of claimant error, public body error, or more significantly for fraud. So there's an assumption, both not just the auditors, but primarily the organisation themselves, have to come up with an approach and a model that sets out their assessment of fraud and error. So Helen can come in and say a bit more about how that's undertaken. And that then falls upon a role of the auditors to take a view about how robust that model is. So the auditors of Social Security Scotland have assessed that, taken a view that that is a reasonable assessment, and that consequently arrive at a figure that you mentioned of £67.5 million of potential overpayment of benefit expenditure.
Could I ask, there's a formula,
yeah,
but you can look back and see how close that formula has actually been in the past to reality. How close has it been?
So if Helen can say a bit more about that, but that's an important part. Mapping all of that is quite complicated, actually, because ultimately this will break down to individual claimant circumstances, which change over time. So at one point you might have an overpayment, and then a legitimate payment, and back payments. So these aren't, it's not a linear process necessarily, I think, as I'm trying to describe. The process overall, though, speaks to the fact that the assessment that the auditors have made is that it is robust, and there is a reasonable figure of between over, if I get the right number, probably of 1.5% to 5.2% of expenditure. Looking forward, before passing to Helen, benefit expenditure in Scotland is going to be growing, you know, as more benefits come online, and that's going to increase the range and potentially the risk. Up until now, it's largely been drawn from DWP estimates, but some of the Scotland-only administered benefits, as we set out in our report on Social Security to the committee last year, it will be an important component of Social Security Scotland's own evolution that they themselves have robust and reliable arrangements for estimating fraud and error. And just to reassure the committee, that remains part of our audit of Social Security Scotland, and we'll be reporting further as necessary. I'll stop for a moment, Mr. Beattie, and get past to Helen, who can say a bit more.
Thank you. So the estimate is calculated over the range of payments made by the Department of Work and Pensions. So this covers such areas as the personal independence payment, and attendance allowance and a few others. It's calculated over the £3.3 billion, and each type of benefit has its own percentage rate, if you like, applied. It's been assessed by the Department of Work and Pensions, and each benefit has been assessed at different times as well. Some have been actually looked at closely, and they've actually worked out a more exact percentage according to their own processes, obviously. The latest one being for attendance allowance, which was actually assessed in 2021-22. As you've already heard, the range covers 1.5% up to 5.2%. And across each of these individual benefits, the total is 67.5. And it's important to stress that this is an estimate of overpayments, an estimate of fraud and error within the overpayments. In terms of, you've heard from the just there about the increase in benefits in terms of that will be made from Scotland. This covers areas such as the Scottish Child Payment, which during 21-22, which was the first full year of reporting, totaled 56 million, and that was an increase of over 50 million from last year. And there's a range of other benefits that will be increasing as well and will be taken on board by Scotland. Thank you.
So these estimates, which, as you say, the 67.5 is the sort of the average across a number of different component parts. Historically, how accurate has it been?
I can maybe say a bit more about that, actually. So this is ultimately referring to DWP's estimates of fraud and error. That...
Yes, I'll come to Social Security Scotland in a second.
OK, thank you. The auditors of the DWP have... drawn attention to the reliability of this estimate in their annual audit report for many years. about the concerns about the overall reliability of that, encouraging DWP to undertake more work, more sample testing to improve the reliability of it.
So are you saying it's not that accurate?
So,
if so, which way?
Yes, accuracy is a term that I think we'd hesitate to apply. These are estimates. So in terms of fraud and error, ultimately relies upon sample testing to assess it. We're now in a position where they're assessed that the estimate is more reliable than it had been as a result of additional investment that DWP has put into reviewing the approach and methodology. And that allows the Auditor of Social Security Scotland to form a view about the reliability of that estimate. And that's something that they are satisfied on. Just to complete, Mr. Beattie, what it still leads the Auditor of Social Security Scotland to do is to amend their audit opinion. So they have drawn attention to this level of overpayment, ultimately because an overpayment of benefit is money that had not been intended by the Scottish Parliament when it approved the budget. So there's a complex series of kind of linked connections about assessing the individual claims sample basis through to the overall assessment of the expected level of fraud and error through to what the auditor's judgment has been. We're seeing progress from DWP, because back to the point for me about actually it matters now that Social Security Scotland have their own parallel arrangements for the Scotland-only administered benefits.
What I'm not hearing from you is that the estimated figures that are being produced annually are actually able to be compared back to an actual figure that somehow is thrown out, even if historically.
So that's not something that we've specifically looked at during the course of this audit, and ultimately will be a matter for DWP and their auditors as they progress through to preparation of robust arrangements for the prevention and detection of fraud and overpayment. What we do know, and really building on evidence we provided to the committee in previous years on Social Security, is that those arrangements are improving. But what I don't have today, and we can come back to the committee in writing, as to what the level of estimated fraud has translated to any recoveries or precise accurate calculations on top of the estimates that were produced.
It would be interesting to see the estimates over a period of several years to see how they've swung back and forward, or if it's fairly constant.
I think you probably see there is quite a range. Actually, and I think that will be spread across a number of benefits between the 1.5% and 5.2%. We'll look at what further detail we have and can share that with the committee in writing. If there's anything further, it may be that the DWP or Social Security Scotland can support the committee's interest.
So coming to Social Security Scotland specifically, in the early years, not that long ago, when Social Security Scotland was put in place, there was a relatively relaxed regime in terms of fraud. And that was gradually tightened up as the volumes increased and the complexity moved on. Do you think that the Scottish Government has given you enough assurance around the assessment of fraud in this year's accounts?
That's the auditor's view, yes, that they have been satisfied with the level of assessment, but they are drawing attention to the increasing volume and risk, as Helen mentions, as more benefits are coming on stream that are Scotland only. It will be the balance for Social Security Scotland to strike between having a benefit system in Scotland that meets its original intentions of supporting dignity, kindness, fairness and respect of people accessing the benefit system at most challenging periods of their lives, but at the same time securing public expenditure. And they make that recommendation in their report that as Social Security Scotland further invests in its fraud prevention arrangements, that it continues to have a foot in both camps. That it's got a robust set of processes, but one that's also consistent and fair. the auditors are very clear that's part of their interest and my interest for their audit work in this year and next.
Are there specific gaps or are there areas that the auditor believes there's certain weaknesses in that the Scottish Government should be focusing on?
Maybe to fair, Mr. Beattie, the report we did on Social Security Scotland and progress in delivering devolved benefits, one of the areas that we talked about was both the investment and size of the team, but the training arrangements, investment in IT to support anti-fraud measures. All of these will be components of it, that they've got the right information, that the data flows and where relevant from DWP. So I think Social Security Scotland knows the factors with which they need to invest to have that rounded regime, and we're alert to it. We're continuing to factor that into our forward work.
Just on a slightly different angle, you may recall some months ago we had a discussion on COVID-19 and the business grants payments and the fraud levels there, and that came through local government, of course. I raised an issue that south of the border, the fraud levels were massive, I mean, running into many billions, and yet in Scotland it was considered to be extremely small, which I'm pleased about, but you're suspicious about as well. And you were at the time having another look at that. Now, according to this, there was a recovery of £504,000 in fraudulent COVID-19 business grant payments as of July 22. Does that really reflect the level of fraud? Does it reflect good progress?
So I remember our discussion on this, Mr. Beattie. I think our scepticism, and healthy scepticism at that, about the comparability between Scotland and the rest of the UK in terms of anticipated or suspected fraud or error in COVID grants. I think we repeat the figure here that we've done in our COVID-19 reports of estimated fraud or error between 1% and 2% of business grants. That is a sharp contrast between some of the COVID-related fraud concerns elsewhere. Bounce back loans, for example, has been a very high-profile example of UK schemes that have been subject to high levels of fraud and error. Part of the reason that Scotland hasn't had that experience is that it has, rather than setting up a specific new scheme and arrangements, such as bounce back loans, that it has deployed existing arrangements through local authorities, used their existing fraud and error detection arrangements, principally through the work of internal auditors in Scottish local authorities. These arrangements have served them well. You know, look at the totality of fraud relative to the scale of the schemes. The hundreds of thousands of error in overall terms, there always will be fraud and error in some schemes, particularly where there is pace with which to get money to where it was needed, as was absolutely the case. The local authorities, other public bodies will continue to monitor progress and recover as necessary. But I think in overall terms, this is something of a success story relative to what we've seen elsewhere.
So £500,000 is good progress?
Michael might want to say a bit more about this, but I don't think the comparability of that figure stands poorly against some of the scale of other figures. None of us want to see any public money being spent in error or fraud, but given the pace with which money needed to be spent during the pandemic, for all the reasons that we recall, that level of fraud and error of between 1% and 2% isn't a significant risk or concern that we are commenting on. I'm saying Michael wants to add.
Just to say that figure that you quote, 504,000, will increase because it's provided in the accounts as a figure to date. The Scottish Government are actively working with their local authority partners to analyse those levels of fraud. It takes a wee bit of time to identify a fraud and confirm it's a fraud. There's quite a lot of process to go through. And then from that stage, claiming the money back can often be challenging. But so that will be an ongoing process. And the number will rise as the Scottish Government gets richer information and ongoing information from local authorities.
Just one last question on this particular.
We're up against the clock a bit here, so if it's a very brief question, I'll allow you to come in and ask.
OK, it kind of relates to what I spoke to before about is Social Security Scotland taking enough measures, or are there other measures they should take to assess levels of fraud and error with the benefits that are administered directly by them?
So that's effectively the challenge we speak to in the paper, that as their responsibilities grow, so too will their fraud teams, and the overall arrangements to secure that fraud and error is minimised as closely as possible. We're continuing to track that progress against the recommendations that we made in our 2022
paper. But it is happening.
Indeed, it is happening. Yes. But what we haven't come to a view yet is how successful those arrangements have been.
Operation with that. I mean, we are against the clock. There are some areas I think we're going to follow up in writing for completeness, but I've got there are a couple of final areas where we've got questions that I do think it would be useful to put to you this morning, so it's on the record. And I'm going to turn to Willie Coffey, who's got some questions about reporting on performance.
Thanks, Willie. Again, convener. I'll put those questions into one question, convener, to save some time. But just in relation to the previous discussion we had, Auditor General, about the public sector consolidated accounts, you referred to an IT issue at HM Treasury. Is it resolved, and does it prevent us making the progress that you hope we'll make?
I'll ask Michael if he's got an up-to-date position, but the whole of government accounts, as you may know, Mr. Coffey, bring in all of UK public expenditure, so there is that single view. Not to labour the point, but we think there needs to be a Scottish version of that. The IT position has delayed progress, and effectively this is submissions from public bodies, from auditors into UK government to collate all of those numbers. That's been a relevant factor in why it's been delayed. If Michael has an up-to-date position, he can share it with the committee.
As far as I understand, it has been resolved. So it's now for the Scottish Government to allocate the necessary resource and prioritise it, if they so wish.
Great stuff. My question just on performance reporting, convener, that is a common thread at the committee, just to give you an opportunity, Auditor General, to say a few words about this and our pursuit of linking spend to outcomes and targets and so on. So could you just say a few words about what your recommendations will be in that area, and I'll leave it at that, convener.
Yeah. Many thanks, Mr. Coffey. It is really that, actually. We'd like to see the consolidated accounts have a closer connection between public spending and associated outcomes against defined measurable targets. The commentary on performance reporting, although it has improved this year, and it's important I recognise that, still tends to be about performance spending against budget rather than the benefits, the outcomes that have been achieved from that. Having a more rounded picture analysis of public spending against measurable targets, contributions to the national outcomes, would be a step forward for transparency, understanding of how well public money has been spent in Scotland.
Mm-hmm. Would you similarly recommend that approach be adopted in the levelling up money spent?
As you know, Mr. Coffey, it's not for me to make recommendations to the UK government. I'm happy to confine my comments to Scottish public bodies. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Willie. The final area that I just wanted to ask a final question about was sponsorship arrangements, i.e. the relations between the Scottish Government and public bodies. And I think in 2021, an external review was commissioned by the Government, which produced 14 key recommendations. All of the 14 recommendations were accepted by the Scottish Government, and I think the Permanent Secretary gave an undertaking that all of the recommendations will be implemented by the end of calendar year 2022. And I know we're only in mid-January 2023. But I do reflect on the fact that in your report that's before us today, you went so far as to say that the Scottish Government has committed to improving its sponsorship arrangements of public bodies, but I remained concerned as to whether the timescales will be met and whether actions planned will fully address each recommendation. Yeah. Where are we today with that?
I'll give my viewing where we're at, Convener Michael can come in and say a bit further, and do correct me if I'm misleading the committee. It's our understanding, I think 11 of the 14 recommendations have been completed. And as you know, we've gone further in the paper just to express some reservations about whether this will actually lead to improved sponsorship arrangements. The committee heard evidence from the government towards the end of last year. And one of the features of that, I think, was the level of turnover within sponsored teams, the level of seniority with which to support public bodies from within government. And that's not something that's going to be easily replicated, to have that, you know, detailed understanding, support, the sophistication of guidance that sponsored teams need to provide to public bodies. So even with all the recommendations, which I'm sure will ultimately be delivered in short order, it matters perhaps a bit like the investment framework that we spoke about earlier, that that's subject to ongoing review and testing. So like other factors, I don't feel in a position to give assurance yet that those arrangements, even with the recommendations, will yet be effective. It's going to be part of our work on an ongoing basis, not just in the Scottish Government, but elsewhere too, about how well those sponsorship arrangements are working in practice. I'll stop for me. I think Michael may wish to update.
That was the 11 out of 14 have been complete. That was the picture as reported to the Government's Audit Committee in November. Of the three outstanding ones, there was nothing that I saw would really mean that the December timescale or anything significantly beyond that would be under threat. But the key point the Auditor General made is that, so these are actions the Scottish Government have taken to respond to the recommendations. Whether that fully addresses the recommendation is where we have concerns. For example, the role of portfolio accountable officers to clearly understand the roles and responsibilities of sponsor teams across public bodies is quite a big recommendation. The action taken is to provide more guidance. That's a slightly different issue. It will help, but it will take more time for these recommendations to really be, I think, fully implemented beyond the initial actions taken by the Scottish Government.
Well, thank you very much indeed. I think that's been a really useful session for us, and I very much appreciate the input that you've given us, Michael, Helen, Auditor General. Thank you very much indeed. And as I said, there may be things that we will want to follow up which have come out of the questioning, and some things we didn't quite get to in the time allocated this morning. But can I thank you very much for your evidence this morning, and I'd now like to close the public part of this morning's proceedings.